Okay, the next item of business is debate on motion 13292 in the name of Angela Constance on Post Office Horizon System Offences Scotland Bill. At stage one, I'd invite members wishing to take part to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible, and I call on Angela Constance to speak to and move the motion. Cabinet Secretary, around 15 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I open this debate with thanks to members of this chamber for passing the motion to treat the Post Office Horizon System Offences Scotland Bill as an emergency bill, reflecting the collective desire of the Scottish Parliament to act at pace to ensure the victims of the Post Office Horizon scandal can finally have their convictions overturned and access redress. Presiding Officer, I want to highlight, firstly, how we arrived here. In 1996, the Post Office introduced the Horizon software, an online accounting system engineered by Fujitsu in some of its branches, and the software was rolled out across the network of branches in 2000. And from there began the story of one of the largest miscarriages of justice this country has ever seen. Faults in the software meant that some sub-postmasters' accounts showed false shortfalls. What happened thereafter and the horrific experiences of the sub-postmasters is well catalogued. However, given that they are the victims in this saga and the lie at the very heart of this bill, it is important that we revisit this painful history. Over a 20-year period, sub-postmasters were forced to repay shortfalls shown by an erroneous system. Throughout the UK, many were suspended or dismissed from jobs that were a vital part of their lives. Others were prosecuted, with nearly 1,000 convicted and some imprisoned for no fault of their own. These allegations and prosecutions had a ruinous impact on innocent sub-postmasters and their families. Some were made bankrupt, some lost their homes, some were branded thieves by their communities, and some took their own lives. Following various unsuccessful attempts to expose the scandal, in 2016, a group of 555 people took the Post Office to the High Court in England. In December 2019, Post Office Limited reached a settlement of £57.75 million to conclude this case. The findings in this litigation identified and confirmed beyond doubt the extent of the problems with Horizon and the adverse impact that those problems had on prosecutions across the UK. And I pay tribute to the sub-postmasters who have worked to expose the failings of the Post Office Limited and have been relentless in their pursuit of justice. While we cannot simply undo their traumatic experiences, we must do all that we can to address the miscarriage of justice. And of course, I'll give way to Mr Ewing.
Fergus Ewing.
The Lord Advocate is not with us this afternoon, Presiding Officer, but is it not the case that back in 2013, the Crown Office was informed by the Post Office and their lawyers that there were flaws with the Horizon system? And indeed, the Crown Office provisionally decided to terminate prosecutions. Does the Cabinet Secretary believe we've had an adequate explanation from the Crown Office as to why they continued with the prosecutions despite having evidence and being told that the Horizon system was flawed? And were they not at best naive in wholly swallowing what they were told by Post Office Limited?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I'm sure Mr Ewing will forgive me if I resist the opportunity to get drawn into the details in which the Lord Advocate has now laid out twice in parliamentary statements and, of course, has answered a number of extensive questions. I suppose the one thing that I would point Mr Ewing to and members is the High Court opinion that was published on the 30th of April regarding those convicted cases, and the judgment that was made by the Court on the 30th of April endorsed the approach taken by the Crown Office but also the Scottish Criminal Cases Review Commission in regards to their assessment of the different circumstances in which Horizon played a role and also in concluding that the appeals should succeed. Presiding Officer, on the 13th of March, the UK Government introduced their Post Office Horizon System Offences Bill at Westminster, which aims to overturn convictions of those sub-postmasters who have suffered as a result of the Post Office Horizon IT scandal. However, the bill as introduced excluded Scotland and Northern Ireland from its remit, despite repeated attempts to engage with the UK Government and a request to take a UK-wide approach to the bill to ensure parity of justice for all sub-postmasters. The UK Government excluded Scotland from the remit of its bill. We have always, however, maintained that while a single UK bill would be the best way to ensure all postmasters can access justice on an equal footing, that we would not hesitate to pursue a Scottish bill should this be deemed necessary. It is now clear that a Scottish bill is the only way to ensure that sub-postmasters can have their convictions quashed and as a result be entitled to UK government compensation. While talking about the bill, it's also important to highlight the excellent work carried out by the Scottish Criminal Cases Review Commission. As members in the Chamber know, the determination of innocence or guilt in criminal cases in Scotland is usually, rightly, a matter for the independent judiciary, and robust processes already exist under Scots law to address potential miscarriages of justice. The Commission is an independent body which has the power to review and investigate cases where it is alleged that a miscarriage of justice may have occurred. Under the Criminal Procedure Scotland Act 1995, where a miscarriage of justice may have occurred and it is in the interest of justice to do so, the Commission can refer a case to the High Court for a fresh appeal. Such a reference can be made at any time and regardless of whether an appeal has already been considered. A number of Horizon cases have been referred to the High Court by the Commission and a number of convictions have subsequently been overturned on appeal. The High Court referrals, of course, only represent those who have come forward to have their cases considered. A number of the cases affected by the Horizon IT failings are over 20 years old, with some of the victims having passed away. Many others are in declining health or have, understandably, lost faith in the justice system and do not wish to engage further. In 2020, the Commission took the unusual step of writing to those whose cases may have been impacted by the tainted Horizon evidence to advise them that they could have grounds to challenge their conviction. The majority of people written to did not contact the Commission. The current system relies on sub-postmasters choosing to engage with the Commission, which then makes a reference to the High Court for an appeal to be heard, a process which many may not want to go through given their lack of trust in the system. It also relies on there being evidence to support the grounds of appeal, and in many cases that evidence no longer exists. Continuing in this way, therefore, would not achieve the objective of ensuring that all wrongful convictions are quashed. And of course, I'll give way.
Holly McNeill.
Thank you to the Cabinet Secretary for giving away. Do you think it would be possible to get some information before we get to stage two about all the cases that have been in front of the Criminal Appeal Court and what we know, any information about what we know is in the pipeline? It would be quite useful to know so far how many cases that we might be dealing with here.
Cabinet Secretary.
Officer, it might be somewhat difficult to access historical information given the passage of time, and I just want to be very upfront with members on that. But in terms of the number of cases that are in process, I can indeed confirm that with members. I'll do that in writing tonight. But in short, 19 individuals have responded to the Scottish Criminal Cases Review. Six have been for appeal successfully recently. Two are in process of the appeal process currently, and there are nine cases that the Commission is currently reviewing. But I will follow up with as much detail as is available. Presiding Officer, I recognise the gravity of taking this unusual step of quashing convictions by way of legislation. However, the unprecedented scale of the miscarriages of justice caused by the Horizon IT system means that the steps proposed by this bill are necessary. The aim of this bill, simply stated, is to provide a quick, fair and equal solution for all sub-postmasters who were wrongly convicted as a result of the impact of the defective Horizon IT system. Through this bill, we want to ensure that Scottish sub-postmasters are not disadvantaged compared to those in the rest of the UK in respect of the quashing of convictions and are able to access the UK Government Compensation Scheme. The bill, as introduced, provides that convictions for relevant offences will be automatically quashed when the bill comes into force. The bill provides that the conviction must have taken place before the coming into force of the legislation. At present, the bill also provides that the conviction must not have been considered by the High Court in the context of an appeal. However, I will be lodging an amendment after the debate today to remove the exclusion of the High Court appeals. This is, in my view, a fairer way to deal with those who may have sought to challenge their conviction by lodging an appeal, especially at a time when the flaws in the Horizon system were not known. As the UK bill includes an exclusion for Court of Appeal cases, I have written to Minister Kevin Hollenrake and received a written assurance from him that the UK government will provide identical access to compensation schemes irrespective of whether the conviction is quashed on a different basis from the rest of the UK. The bill also sets out five conditions that must be met in order for the conviction to be quashed by the bill. These conditions are deliberately designed so as not to require any element of discretion in order to be applied, allowing for the automatic quashing of convictions which fall within the ambit of the legislation. The five conditions relate to the date on which the offence or the offences were committed, the type of offence, the need for the individual to have both been working in a post office and have carried out the offence in connection with the post office business, and the need for Horizon system to have been in use by the post office at the time of the offence. Turning to a couple of these conditions in particular, the bill covers offences committed between the 23rd of September 1996 and 31st of December 2018. This matches the time frame in which the Horizon system and its pilots is known to have been in operation, with the 31st of December the point being at which the rollout of the current version of the Horizon scheme, considered to be robust, was concluded. The list of offences covered by the bill is one area in which this bill differs from its UK counterpart. The offences covered by the bill are embezzlement, fraud, theft and uttering. Embezzlement and uttering are not offences which exist in England and Wales. Conversely, the bill does not include the offence of money laundering or any equivalent to the English and Welsh offences of handling stolen goods. The offences selected are those that were prosecuted in Scotland in cases involving the tainted evidence from the Horizon IT scheme. The bill also contains details of the administrative process for identifying which convictions have been quashed, securing the amendment of records of those convictions and notifying relevant individuals. There are two important provisions in this regard that I would like to highlight to the Chamber. Firstly, the bill places a duty on the Scottish Ministers to take all reasonable steps to identify those convictions and to notify anyone whose conviction has been quashed. Secondly, the bill places a duty on the Scottish Ministers to consider representations made to them by a convicted person or a third party that someone has a conviction for a relevant offence. This will ensure that where a conviction is not identified by the Scottish Ministers, but a person believes that their conviction satisfies the criteria and has been quashed, and the Scottish Ministers are obliged to consider representations made on that person's behalf. A further difference in the Scottish Bill is that it empowers the Scottish Ministers to impose a requirement on any person to provide information that they hold, which the Scottish Ministers consider is necessary for the fulfilment of their functions. There is no direct counterpart to this power in the UK Bill. This power has been included on the basis that Scottish Ministers will need to obtain information from other persons in order to successfully identify the convictions that have been quashed by the Bill. The required information is likely to be held by a range of organisations, including the Scottish Criminal Cases Review Commission, the Crown Office, Post Office Limited, Police Scotland and the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service. Presiding Officer, I am of the view that Stage 3 of the Bill should not be completed until the equivalent UK Bill has been passed by the UK Parliament, so as to allow us to consider any amendments to the UK Bill and make equivalent amendments where appropriate. We are absolutely committed to do everything in our power to minimise any time lags between the UK Bill and the Scottish Bill coming into force. It is therefore my intention to seek to hold the amending part of Stage 3 before summer recess, once it is clearer what the final form of the UK Bill will be, but for the as-passed Stage 3 debate to be held only once the UK Bill is passed. I will also seek to shorten the time frame for receiving Royal Assent. I have already written to the offices of the Advocate General, the Lord Advocate, the Attorney General and the Secretary of State for Scotland, indicating our desire to accelerate post-Stage 3 consideration. Once the Bill comes into force, Scottish Ministers will work closely with Justice partners in identifying those convictions quashed by the Bill, securing the amendment of the records of those convictions and notifying relevant individuals. Presiding Officer, as the Bill rightly undergoes scrutiny, I am committed to working constructively across the Chamber to ensure Scottish postmasters are not left behind and they receive the parity of justice that they rightly deserve. And I know that the nature of this Bill, Presiding Officer, is unprecedented, and as parliamentarians, we are making decisions we have never had to before. I hope members will agree that this Bill is the only way now to overturn the horrendous miscarriages of justice suffered by postmasters in Scotland, and I will endeavour to work very closely with members. And I move the motion in my name, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Before calling the next speaker, a gentle reminder to those who wish to participate in the debate, if they haven't already pressed the request to speak buttons, to do so now. And I call Russell Findlay, around 11 minutes, please, Mr Findlay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Post Office Horizon IT system generated a wave of unexplained financial deficits, with black holes appearing suddenly in branch accounts across the country. Post Office executives concluded that hundreds of sub-postmasters, trusted pillars of local communities, were all, in fact, thieves. This was utterly implausible. But these decent people were bullied and coerced into paying back vast sums they had not taken. Many of these innocent people were dragged through criminal courts where they were wrongly convicted. Steamrolled by the justice system, their desperate protestations were dismissed. Ostracised, humiliated, and financially ruined. Many were broken and went to an early grave. Some did so with a terrible sense of shame. When Phil and Fiona Cowan reported apparent shortfalls at their branch in Edinburgh, they were told there were no problems with Horizon. This lie, and it was that no one else had been questioned the veracity of Horizon, was a standard tactic. Having been charged with false accounting, Fiona was spat at in the street. She died of an accidental overdose in 2009, having not even been told that the charges against her had been dropped. Phil says that, and I quote, "I have no doubt that the horror of the post office fiasco was a major factor in her death." In 2009, Karen Lorimer was forced to admit embezzlement from her post office in Kilmarnock. As the mum of a four-year-old son, she did so to avoid being sent to prison. Her husband, David, is still ensnared in Scotland's glacial justice system, fighting to clear her name. Like Fiona Cowan, Karen did not live long enough to see the groundbreaking ITV drama Mr Bates versus the Post Office. Nor did former police officer Mary Philp, who was publicly branded a thief and suspended from her branch in Auchtermuchty. In Greenock, Keith McIldowie was brought to the brink of suicide after being forced to resign and pay thousands of pounds to the post office. Rab Thompson was also falsely accused of theft from Cambus Barron post office. His own lawyer advised him to plead guilty to a crime that he did not commit, worse still, a crime that did not even happen. Rab describes his ordeal as degrading and embarrassing and laments the unbearable strain it put on his late mother, Margaret. Sisters Rose Stewart and Jackie El-Kasbi were ordered to hand over thousands of pounds after being falsely accused of stealing from their post office in Glasgow's Gorbals. They knew they were innocent, but say they were made to feel ashamed as if they were pieces of dirt. Presiding Officer, the post office Fujitsu Horizon scandal is perhaps the greatest mass miscarriage of justice in our country's legal history. But this was no mere computer glitch. This was worse than that, much worse. The post office, a once trusted institution, appears to have fallen under the spell of some kind of boardroom mafia. For almost two decades, they directed armies of aggressive lawyers and thuggish investigators. They sought mediation with victims, then sabotaged the process with bad faith. They aggressively hounded and crushed those they knew to be innocent. They weaponised the criminal justice system in Scotland, just as they did in England and Wales. And when the truth began to slowly emerge, they lied and lied and continued to lie. Conniving and corrupt, the scale and audacity of their cover-up was breathtaking and reprehensible, with a judge calling their dishonest defence of Horizon, as, and I quote, the 21st century equivalent of maintaining that the earth is flat. I will.
Keith Brown.
Well, Finlay, for taking the intervention. Just to say that my constituent, Rab Thompson, is from Cambus, not Cambus Barn, which is in Stirling. We've heard, consistent with what Russell Finlay said, that the Post Office, its lawyers and UK government ministers continued to support the Horizon system during 2013 to 2015, by which time we knew of the issues with the Horizon software and there were worrying levels of deliberate and sustained concealment and deception. Given that, does Russell Finlay think there should be criminal proceedings against those in the UK government, the Post Office and the lawyers that carried on that deception?
Russell Finlay.
I apologise to Mr Brown's constituent for the geographical mix-up, and the Post Office inquiry will fully get to the bottom of all these matters, and I do come on to the issue of criminal prosecutions. It was in 2006 that Computer Weekly magazine reported the first concerns about Fujitsu's Horizon system. Sub-postmaster Alan Bates, who is a true hero of modern Britain, launched and led a campaign for justice. From the media, telling a complex story about a flawed IT system was challenging, but some journalists have been dogged in their pursuit. Nick Wallace was doing the hard yards long before Mr Bates' drama reached our TV screens. His Post Office scandal website contains an abundance of detailed and clear information. He also contributed to sustained coverage in Private Eye, whose in-depth Justice Lost in the Post report is compelling. This credits numerous politicians, not least my Conservative colleague, the former MP James Arbuthnot, who fought tirelessly for victims. We know who some of the villains are, we know who some of the victims are, and we know some of the heroes. The ongoing public inquiry will continue to work on those fronts, but what we do not yet know is exactly what happened here in Scotland, where the Crown Office had sole responsibility for prosecuting every single Horizon case. In England and Wales, all prosecutions were conducted by the Post Office. They controlled the evidence, they decided what to disclose and what to keep hidden from defence lawyers and courts. There is evidence that the Post Office perverted the course of justice, and I urge a robust criminal investigation. But why did the Crown Office continue to put Scottish sub-postmasters in the dock after it was widely known that Horizon evidence was not reliable? Some legal experts believe that with the Crown in control of all Scottish cases, our sub-postmasters should have been protected. The Crown had to be independently convinced about the integrity of the Post Office evidence. Crown prosecutors had to stand up in courts and lead the evidence with absolute confidence. Furthermore, under Scots law, Horizon evidence would need to have been corroborated by other evidence. I ask, was the corroboration rule properly applied? In one recorded interview, Karen Lorimer was told by a Strathclyde police detective that Horizon was, quote, completely and utterly foolproof, and that nobody would believe her. Fearful of being thrown behind bars, she pled guilty. a desperate young mum's confession to the Scottish Police used to corroborate Horizon evidence in a Scottish court. As far back as 2013, as we've already heard from Fergus Ewing, we know that some concerned Crown Office prosecutors believed that all Horizon cases should be, quote, terminated. Post Office lawyers came to Edinburgh on a mission to persuade and placate the Crown's jitters. They were successful. Did the Crown just take what they were told at face value? Where was the curiosity? This moment seems to have been a massive missed opportunity for Scotland's Prosecution Service and Post Office victims. I'm not sure if I have time for an intervention.
I can give you a bit of that time back.
Okay, thank you.
Fergus Ewing.
On that point, Mr. Kenneth Donnelly, the senior figure in the Crown Office, stated that they were provisionally minded to terminate prosecutions when they got the information in 2013 about Helen Rose and Second Sight. But they didn't do so after lawyers for the Crown, Post Office said that if they did so, this would, quotes from Mr. Donnelly's own statement, raise a considerable public relations storm. Since when is that a proper consideration for the Crown Office to consider?
Russell Findlay.
Yeah, I absolutely share Fergus Ewing's incredulity at that statement. Now, since that 2013 meeting, at least four more were prosecuted and convicted. It was not until 2 years later, 2015, that the Crown decided that it would no longer prosecute Horizon cases due to mounting concerns. But they appear to have done nothing in regard to the convictions that they had already secured. For 5 years, it appears that no victims were written to, no cases re-examined, no convictions overturned. In 2019, Mr. Bates and hundreds of others won their group action. Surely this would jolt the Crown into taking responsibility for their past actions. I would have expected them to conduct a thorough audit of every single Horizon case. I would have expected them to do whatever was needed to urgently contact every single possible Scottish victim. Their legal duty to disclose all relevant evidence to an accused does not end at the point of conviction. Yet it was not until 2020 that the Scottish Criminal Cases Review Commission wrote to 73 potential victims. It's staggering that we still don't know how many potential Horizon victims there are in Scotland. Of the 73 written to, only 19 came forward. Did they just stick a letter on the post and hope for the best? Did they write to dead people? It seems a remarkably low take-up. 4 years later, just six of those 19 have had their convictions overturned. The Lord Advocate, who sits in the Cabinet table, has twice attended Parliament to answer questions. She was not in charge when all of this was happening. That was Frank Mulholland, who's now High Court judge. Parliament has not heard from him. However, a BBC journalist resorted to challenging him in the street, resulting in a welcome apology, but little more. The current Lord Advocate does not appear to support the blanket exoneration of her own government's legislation. In January, she told Parliament, and I quote, "The process we have in place is the right one, and that, quote, it is imperative that due process be followed." Last week, I asked her if she backed the bill, but she would not say, citing collective ministerial responsibility. Presiding Officer, we welcome this legislation, but I do remain dismayed at SNP tactics of using Horizon to pick a silly fight with UK ministers. It's evident that the most effective route to justice is separate Scottish legislation, not least, as we heard today, in respect of specific Scottish offences. Every single political party is committed to this. Speed of delivery and simplicity is vital. At some point, someone will put a financial cost on this shameful episode. However, the human cost will remain incalculable. So let's get this done. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Findlay. I now call Polly McNeill, around 9 minutes. Ms. McNeill.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This is a very important week in the Post Office inquiry, as Paula Venables gives evidence tomorrow for 3 days. And as others have said, it is the biggest miscarriage of justice in British legal history. And I do agree with Keith Brown that as a result of it, there should be criminal proceedings. I hope that there are. The cover-ups, the lies told and the dysfunctional nature of the Post Office internal investigation and prosecution functions led to the ruining of many lives, not just sub-postmasters, but their families too. Suicides, financial ruin, and families who left the country due to the talk of scandal in small villages. It must never be allowed to happen again. Politicians, including government ministers, should take note of their role for those who did not listen to sub-postmasters and for those who did not question when there was an obvious sniff about the reliability of the judge's computer system, Horizon. We owe Alan Bates a great deal for having the strength to take this on, this institution that did everything to intimidate, bully and make criminals of sub-postmasters. In 2019, Justice for Postmasters Alliance won a High Court case. The bugs and errors and defects were found in the Horizon system, causing discrepancies in postmasters' branch accounts. But despite winning this compensation to victims, the question of compensation has still not been satisfactorily dealt with. But Computer Weekly wrote an article as far back as 2009 questioning the issues with Horizon. It's been long known about. And what we've heard these last few weeks in the Post Office public inquiry has been quite shocking. Chief Communication Officer Mark Davis, following news that a sub-postmaster, Martin Griffiths, who had suffered huge unexplained losses, was critically ill after attempting to take his own life, and his actions in this regard were to hire a specialist media lawyer while he bragged about his political connections and how he might steer MPs away from looking closely at the issues of Horizon. But thankfully, many MPs did not turn away. Alistair Cameron, who was the Chief Operating Officer, said that when he joined in 2015, there was an attempt to shut down Second Sight, the organisation, the forensic accountants, who were hired to independently review Horizon. So there was unease that they were in fact doing their job. Second Sight were sacked in 2015 for doing their job after completing its damning report. Surely then alarm bells were ringing all up and down the United Kingdom. They revealed that the Post Office had prosecuted sub-postmasters for theft and false accounting without investigating the claims authorising that the system was to blame for the shortfalls. Jarnail Singh, the lawyer, who after presenting the evidence last week, said that he saved an attachment about discrepancies to his hard drive and actually claimed in evidence that he did not know how to save a document. I mean, it's really incredible what we're hearing this week. But this was the man that Russell Findlay refers to, and Fergus Ewing too, who led the team who came to Scotland after panic set in that the Scottish Crown Office was about to recommend that all cases involving Horizon be terminated. In 2013, it's clear that the Post Office had a secret agenda to prevent this policy from happening, because you can imagine the implications of Scotland saying that they would terminate all cases and the ripples this would have caused in England and Wales. Probably, if that had happened, I believe things would have been different. And that is why I think the Scottish Government were wrong to pursue legislation in Westminster. Because if that had happened, I believe there would be less scrutiny of the role of our own Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service. There must be accountable for these decisions, and we still do not yet have full accountability for that. As has been mentioned, the Gorbals Post Office, run by sisters Jackie El-Kasabi and Rose Stewart, the accounts are beginning to show deficits to the tune of £34,000, which we know now didn't really exist. And in 2014, those sisters handed over £10,000 of their own money, as many did, to settle the case. And this was despite the Second Sight report being available for all to see. But it was in 2014 that Prosecutor Angus Crawford was not convinced by the Horizon evidence. He thought it was too weak to stand up in court. And I believe there were other cases that were not proceeded with, and I would like this clarified. After the meeting with Jarnail Singh and Senior Procurator Fiscals, as said previously, the guidelines for Crown Office appeared to change from a recommendation of terminating cases using Horizon as corroboration to one of a case-by-case basis. So this was on the basis of a full report that they said, and it never actually came about. And I assert that if the Post Office had not lied to Procurator Fiscals, and if the Crown Office had stuck to the original recommendation, and as I said at FMQs a few weeks ago, and the Crown Office had been a little less naive, then I don't believe that those four cases would have been proceeded against. And it is the duty of all Procurator Fiscals to disclose if they uncover that there have been unsafe convictions. And we still require an answer from the Lord Advocate as from 2019 forward to this day, why were no victims written to? It is not acceptable. I will give way.
Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Thanks to Polly McNeill for giving way. She will remember the statement from the Lord Advocate last week, who said that there were 11 cases where Procurator Fiscals decided not to take cases forward. Should that not have been ringing alarm bells at the top of the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service if so many individual fiscals were deciding not to pursue cases?
Polly McNeill.
Clay. If I may paraphrase, the dogs in the street knew that there was a sniff around Horizon and Computer Weekly in 2009. So why was that not enough, at least to halt cases at that time? I maintain if they'd stuck to their recommendation, if Crown Office officials had even contacted Second Sight Forensic Accountants, then they would have at least had a conversation, as I have done in my office with Ron Mormington, the director of Second Sight, who said that they could have explained why in their report they said there were bugs and defects and that 76 branches had unreliable accounts. I have other questions about why these four cases were proceeded against using Horizon as a plea of guilty. I will in a minute, because as the Lord Advocate said in her letter to me, in those four cases there was a plea of guilty. But they were obviously innocent. A plea of convenience, it would be called, and it's obviously the case that those victims pleaded in order to get a way out of prosecution.
Yes. Mr. Fergus Ewan.
I'm grateful. Does Pauline McNeill also agree with me that, as Kenneth Donnelly conceded in his evidence to the Wynne Williams inquiry, the obligation of disclosure is in perpetuity. It applies to previous convictions, and therefore in 2013, both the Helen Rose and the Second Sight report should have been copied to every person and their lawyer who had been convicted of Post Office Horizon cases before 2013, and that apparently wasn't done either.
Pauline McNeill.
I agree this is a central question still to be answered by the Crown Office as to why, when it was clear that that evidence used as corroboration may have been unsafe, that is where the duty of disclosure should have applied, and we require answers to that. But why, in cases where no actual money was missing in the first place, as a layperson, I asked the question, were bank accounts checked? Was only the Horizon system that was relied upon? Because in most cases of fraud, then it's a requirement to find where the money went. And crucially, contractually, sub-postmasters were obliged to make good any losses. So given that knowledge, surely any prosecutor would ask the question, what is the motive of a sub-postmaster who is contractually obliged to make good any losses as to whether that would actually be questionable when coming to look at whether or not the evidence was there? I acknowledge and applaud the Scottish Crown Office, who have now stripped the Post Office of their status as a reporting body, but there are many other reporting bodies that report to Crown Office. It's vitally important that lessons are learned here. It's not inconceivable that other reporting bodies are relying on poor evidence, and we need to be sure of that. Presiding Officer, Scottish Labour supports the Government in their emergency legislation to ensure that all victims and all are exonerated. We will never be able to put those lives back together, but we can record this in our dealings, a monumental miscarriage of justice with breathtaking levels of cover-ups and cruelty beyond comprehension, and that we will stand up today and do what we think is right and get those who should be answerable for this dreadful situation to be held to account. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms McNeill. Just to advise the Chamber, the little time we had in hand has now been exhausted, so interventions will need to be accommodated in members' speaking allocations. With that, I call Maggie Chapman. Up to 6 minutes, Ms Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. On behalf of the Scottish Greens, I welcome this bill and recognise its urgency. It is clear that the convictions we discuss today are miscarriages of justice, and they must be quashed. There is, as we have heard, a shared understanding across the Parliament, as there is across Scotland, of how very important this issue is. And so we can, I believe and hope, work together during the course of this week to ensure that our legislation is as robust, as inclusive and as effective as it can possibly be. I want to say just a little about the areas where I consider there is room to make this bill stronger. I am grateful to hear the Cabinet Secretary state her intention to remove the provision that a conviction must not have been previously addressed by the High Court in the context of appeal. As I said in my question to the Lord Advocate after a statement last week, new information and understanding on how the scandal has been handled and dealt with is coming to light via various sources, not least the public inquiry, on an ongoing basis. In the absence of this newer information, those earlier convictions cannot be considered safe. I have amendments planned along similar lines to the Cabinet Secretary on this. I would also want the provisions of the bill to apply to people who were not themselves working in a post office but were convicted along with a person who is covered by the bill. Additionally, if a close relative of someone who worked in a post office was convicted instead, perhaps to save their relative some distress, they too should be covered. These amendments, which we will discuss on Thursday, I believe, will make the bill more robust, more inclusive, and more effective. But this bill is neither the beginning nor the end of the story. It is not the beginning because it builds on the years of arduous campaigning by Alan Bates and others, the years of speaking tenacious truth to perfidious power, the years of countering lies and persecution with courage and comradeship. And it is not the end because those who have survived this ordeal and the families of those who have not still have not received what is properly due to them. It is our responsibility, as well as passing this legislation, meticulously to scrutinise the UK government's schemes of redress. We must ensure, so far as we possibly can, that all who suffered from this monstrous injustice receive full exoneration, satisfactory compensation, and all that they need to resume their fractured lives. That is the absolute minimum. But that is still not the whole story. This tragedy has causes as well as consequences. The wrong that was done by corporations and their senior personnel must be spoken, addressed, and learned from. We live in a society where, almost invariably, crimes of the powerful are overlooked, erased, or treated as anomalies. One bad apple, they say, but sometimes the barrel itself is rotten with a culture of impunity, collusion, abuse, and greed. When the time is right, we must be bold in seeking robust and appropriate penalties, including criminal charges, reflecting the immense harm that has been done. Harm most of all to individuals and their families, but also to communities, to the reputation of once respected institutions, to the rule of law, and to trust itself. And I will be submitting a further amendment on this issue for our discussion on Thursday. We must learn at last some wider lessons about those processes of privatisation and corporatisation that enhance personal rewards for those at the top while removing accountability to the society they are supposed to serve. Lessons about outsourcing without transparency, about what is sacrificed to preserve reputation, about the privileged acting with neither responsibility nor care. It is chilling to reflect that the Post Office's chief executive, for much of this time, was also a minister of the Church of England, preaching upon a gospel that is largely about the oppression of the poor by the rich, the conscientious by the hypocrites, the open-handed by the greedy. There is, it seems, an acceptable disconnect between the personal lives of the powerful, which may be characterised by kindness and decency, and their professional roles, in which integrity is disregarded in a game of status and profit. But this is not a game. It is fundamentally a question of justice, It is fundamentally, apologies, a question for those who have been wrongly convicted in this situation. So, Presiding Officer, we need to address those who endured incarceration, humiliation, loss of livelihood, reputation, home, even life itself. It's not a game for them. It should not be for us. So finally, I would like to reflect on the fact that the scandal might have stayed secret for years, might have robbed hundreds of others of their freedom and well-being, had it not been for the work of those few brave, stubborn and dedicated individuals. This bill is a tribute to all those who, when faced with injustice, didn't give up, didn't allow themselves to be fobbed off with reassurances, scared off by threats, or bought off with less than that which justice demands. We salute them and we thank them.
Thank you, Ms Chapman. Before calling the next speaker, can I just remind the Chamber that we are still in the process of listening to the opening speakers, and anybody participating in the debate will need to be present both for the opening speeches and the closing speeches. With that, I call Beatrice Wishart for up to 6 minutes. Ms Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I too welcome the opportunity to speak this afternoon, and on behalf of Scottish Liberal Democrats can confirm we'll be supporting the general principles of the bill today, and of course we support the intentions of the bill. The treatment of sub-postmasters and sub-postmistresses who were caught up in the Post Office Horizon scandal has been disgraceful. They were victims of a monumental cover-up, with the Post Office long having knowledge of the flaws in the Horizon IT system, gaslighting sub-postmasters and outright lying to ministers when concerns were raised. I pay tribute to all the victims in the Post Office scandal for their search for truth and justice. It should not have taken the ITV drama Mr Bates versus the Post Office to capture the minds of viewers across the UK and bring to a head some form of redress that we are seeing today with the Westminster legislation and this mirror bill. We recognise the need for this bill to remain as close to the similar Westminster legislation as possible, as any deviation could cause delays. The mirrored legislation will ensure that those caught by the provisions of the bill are able to access the UK government compensation scheme. Some have argued that legislation to overturn these convictions is not the ideal route for justice. However, many of those who will be covered by this narrow legislation have already experienced this justice system and lost. I recognise the sense of feeling that asking victims to once again battle in the courts is not the ideal way to address the scandal. Some of these cases go back 20 years, and the reality of persuading those caught up in this to go back to court could be a big ask of them. But if even one wrong conviction stayed in place, justice would not have been realised. The UK-wide compensation scheme will require those seeking compensation to sign a legal statement declaring they did not commit the crime for which they were wrongly convicted before they receive financial redress. Anyone found to have falsely signed could be found guilty of fraud. This should build in some deterrence against anyone looking to cash in on the miscarriage of justice suffered by others. And indeed, as the Lord Bishop of Manchester said during the House of Lords second reading, and I quote, "The principle that it is better that a guilty person go free than an innocent one be convicted lies at the root of our British justice system." Presiding Officer, too often we have seen those in charge cover up following systemic failures. The NHS with infected blood products, the Hillsborough disaster, and the once highly respected Post Office. The way that ordinary people are treated by authority figures in these situations does little to address the issues. Rather, the establishment is more concerned with covering up whatever has gone wrong, fearing any resulting negative public relations coverage, as Fergus Ewing alluded to. It can take years for the relevant authorities to even acknowledge there's a problem. In the case of the Post Office, it was Alan Bates and other affected persons who built networks and tirelessly campaigned to expose establishment cover-ups. Yet still we have dangerous cladding on buildings, rack in schools, sewage in our waterways. There needs to be a cultural shift towards a more transparent and honest way of working in which those in positions of authority take responsibility when things go wrong, that they own it and put it right at the first possible opportunity. When this bill passes, those who have been wrongly convicted will finally have their names cleared. As we saw from the ITV drama, that will have significant impacts on many lives, where a past conviction is a barrier, for example, in situations like helping out in a school. It will not give back those who tragically took their lives from the stress of this struggle, nor reverse the mental ill health that some still endure. Nor does it give back time spent in prison, nor can it give back birthdays missed, children growing up, homes sold. We have to pass this under the accelerated emergency mechanism to bring about swifter justice. We have to realise compensation for those caught up in the scandal. And, Presiding Officer, we have to learn from this. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Wishart. We will now move to the open part of the debate, and I call Ruth Maguire to be followed by Murdo Fraser. Ms Maguire.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The use of tainted evidence provided by the Post Office in criminal cases right across the United Kingdom is one of the largest miscarriages of justice that's occurred in recent history. Some sub-postmasters were suspended or dismissed, and others were prosecuted for offences of dishonesty, with a number being convicted and in some cases imprisoned. This miscarriage of justice has had profound impacts on the people affected by it. Bankruptcy, loss of family homes, individuals hounded as thieves in the communities they lived in and provided trusted services to, breakdowns in relationships with partners, children and friends, and the mental and physical health problems that result from the devastating toll such a distressing and unjust situation takes. Several died by suicide. Estimates suggest that nearly 1,000 individuals were convicted on the basis of evidence from the Horizon system across the United Kingdom over a 20-year period. In Scotland, these prosecutions were brought forward by the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service. In 2020, the Scottish Criminal Cases Review Commission, which investigates possible miscarriages of justice in Scotland, wrote to 73 potential victims of the Horizon scandal. In line with the approach of the UK Government, the Scottish Government believes anyone wrongly convicted as a result of the impact of the defective Horizon IT system should have their conviction quashed and as a result be entitled to UK Government compensation. With a number of the cases affected by the Horizon IT failings being over 20 years old and some victims having passed away, there is also the situation that many are in declining health or have lost faith in the justice system and understandably would not wish to engage further with it. The current system relies on sub-postmasters choosing to lodge an appeal, which many will not want to do for obvious reasons. It also relies on there being evidence that the conviction is unsafe, and in many cases that evidence no longer exists. Continuing with the current system would not achieve the objective of ensuring all wrongful convictions are quashed. The effect of the bill before us is both symbolic and practical. By quashing the convictions of postmasters, it removes the stain from those who were wrongly convicted. However, it also has a practical effect. Under the overturned conviction scheme established by the UK Government, anyone who was wrongly convicted as a result of Horizon evidence is eligible to receive compensation, but only once their conviction has been overturned. So the many postmasters and others who are wrongfully convicted but have not appealed to the courts are unable to access the compensation that they deserve. The UK bill will remove this barrier to access for those who ought to be entitled to financial redress through the compensation schemes, and the bill before us today seeks to do likewise for Scottish postmasters. Given the unique circumstances arising from the endemic failings of the Horizon IT system, it's absolutely right that our Scottish Parliament takes the unprecedented action in the form of primary legislation to quash relevant convictions, rather than relying on the existing justice system to cure the miscarriages of justice that arose. That said, Presiding Officer, undoubtedly the quickest and easiest route to overturn these miscarriages of justice would have been for the UK Government to extend their Post Office Horizon System Offences Bill to cover sub-postmasters in Scotland. I think that many Scottish citizens will find it strange that the UK Government excluded them, and I remain unclear as to why the Scottish Government's repeated requests for inclusion of Scottish victims were refused. But they were, and therefore the Scottish Government's bill before us mirrors that of UK legislation to ensure parity for affected sub-postmasters in Scotland with those elsewhere in the UK, and crucially to ensure access to the UK Government's compensation scheme. Presiding Officer, I am heart sorry that justice has taken so long and for some it is coming far too late, but we'll be glad to vote to progress this bill this evening and move us towards delivering action to ensure sub-postmasters in Scotland affected by wrongful convictions can receive justice by having their convictions quashed and access to compensation that they so gravely deserve. Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Maguire. I now call Murdo Fraser to be followed by Keith Brown. Mr Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Conservatives welcome the bill that's before us. It deals with what is a striking and appalling miscarriage of justice. And there's a striking parallel, I think, with the earlier business we had this afternoon with the contaminated blood scandal, which is yet another horrendous matter of injustice. So we're going to devote two afternoons of parliamentary business this week to the Horizon Post Office situation where, as we've heard from a number of speakers, hundreds of innocent sub-postmasters across the United Kingdom were unfairly accused of theft and fraud. And the personal impact of this was horrendous. Hundreds lost their livelihoods, some having to repay tens of thousands of pounds. Others were prosecuted, some went to prison, some took their own lives. For all those affected, the personal, financial and emotional impact was enormous. And Russell Findlay earlier reminded us of some of the personal stories of those who were impacted by this. And as we now know, these victims were all innocent. There were serious issues with the Horizon software. And horrifically, we now know that at the top of the Post Office, the problems with Horizon were well understood, and yet they did nothing to stop the prosecutions. Now, at last, the UK Government has accepted that all those convicted require to be exonerated, and emergency legislation has been introduced at Westminster to address this. And in parallel, there will be substantial compensation paid out to those who have suffered. It is the least that they should expect. And I'm glad we see this legislation from the Scottish Government today, and I hope the Parliament and all parties will work together to see this passed as expeditiously as possible. But having said that, I do think it is disappointing that we've seen people in the SNP trying to exploit this Horizon political scandal for political purposes, proving there is no situation so tragic it cannot be turned into a constitutional football. In an interview on the 23rd of April, the then First Minister, Hamza Youssef, said he was utterly furious about the fact the UK Government had chosen not to extend their legislation to Scotland. It was, he said, outrageous and unacceptable. But, Presiding Officer, justice is devolved to this Parliament, and the decisions made to take prosecutions in Scotland were not a matter for the Post Office, but entirely a matter for the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service. And had the UK Government tried to introduce a bill to deal with Scottish justice matters, we can only imagine the very first people to complain would have been SNP ministers. But they try and turn the current situation into a constitutional grievance. I'll give way to the Cabinet Secretary.
Cabinet Secretary.
So I'm grateful to Mr Fraser. He's absolutely correct to say that justice is indeed devolved, but that doesn't stop me with great regularity bringing legislative consent motions to this Parliament based on UK-wide legislation. And can I reassure him that I am one of the most pragmatic politicians you'll meet, not much of an ideologue, and my concern was really just simply one of pragmatism and to look for the quickest solution.
Murdo Fraser.
Well, the legislative consent motion she refers to do not normally deal with matters of the criminal justice system in Scotland. And I welcome the moderate tone we've heard from the Cabinet Secretary. It was in stark contrast to what we heard from the former First Minister when he was speaking on this issue just a few weeks ago. And the stance Scottish ministers have taken seems to have put them at odds with the stance taken by the Lord Advocate, who indicated to this Parliament back in January that she would not support blanket exoneration for those convicted of Horizon evidence. She was quite clear at that point that she did not believe every conviction represented a miscarriage of justice, and she referenced the fact that individuals had pled guilty to cases, not recognising, of course, as we've already heard in the debate from Polly McNeill and others, people were often advised to plead guilty to these charges by their solicitors, people who knew perfectly well they were innocent, but because their solicitors told them the Horizon evidence could not be challenged, and therefore they had no alternative to it. Presiding Officer, questions still remain about the conduct of the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, which surely had a duty to weigh the credibility of the Post Office evidence on Horizon before taking prosecutions here. Now, as Fergus Ewing reminded us earlier, we know that concerns were raised about the integrity of the Horizon system with the Crown Office in 2013. But it was a further 2 years before a decision was taken to discontinue prosecutions that relied on that evidence. And we know that there were 4 cases prosecuted after the 2013 meeting that resulted in a conviction. Polly McNeill quoted a case where a Procurator Fiscal was not convinced by the credibility of the Horizon evidence. I was speaking at a lawyers' conference 3 weeks ago. I met a retired Procurator Fiscal who told me, a different individual, who told me he personally had decided not to take forward a Horizon case because he was dissatisfied. And we now know, given what the Lord Advocate told Parliament last week, there were 11 cases which have been identified, in which individual prosecutors decided to suspend consideration of proceedings and take no action as a direct result of their concerns with the accuracy of the Horizon system. Why was this not ringing alarm bells at the top of the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service? Why was the decision not taken at that point to cease all prosecution proceedings? I asked that precise question to the Lord Advocate when she gave evidence here last Thursday, and I did not get a convincing answer. So to close, Deputy Presiding Officer, it's good to see this legislation proceeding, compensation being paid to those who have been treated so unjustly. Well, that doesn't answer the very serious questions that remain about decisions taken by the Prosecution Service here in Scotland, and we need to get answers to these. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Fraser. I now call Keith Brown to be followed by Katie Clark. Mr Brown.
Presiding Officer, I'm very pleased that we are at long last legislating to overturn the convictions of those wrongly convicted in the Post Office Horizon scandal. And many months ago, as we've heard, I was contacted by Rab Thompson, a constituent of mine, former sub-postmaster of Cambus Post Office, one of around 100 Scots who were wrongly convicted because of the scandal. And even a year ago, when the faults with the Horizon system were already widely known, Rab was struggling to get his conviction overturned. And just on the issue that's now been raised, the politicisation of this about where responsibility lies, it should be said, of course, that this whole scenario started in Westminster. Concerns were first raised about the system in 1997 to the new government at that point. And it centres on a body whose responsibility is entirely reserved to the UK government. Perhaps you'd remember that, because some people seem to be wanting to elide that point. From the point I met with Rab, my constituency team and I did what we could to support him, countless letters to relevant organisations, being vocal in the press, raising parliamentary questions on the issue. And indeed, I met Rab not long before his hearing, and I'm very pleased to report that he was amongst the first wrongly convicted postmasters in Scotland to get his conviction overturned in January of this year. As I said, Presiding Officer, the postmasters have known about this scandal for decades. The public have known about this scandal for years. I think Polly McNeill used the phrase, the dogs in the street knew about the scandal. So we have to ask ourselves, how did it go on for so long? We now know that a number of people in positions of power knew about this, and had they done things differently, we would not be in this situation today. As the Lord Advocate said, and I do not want to attack the Lord Advocate, I'm sorry, I don't really have much time. I've been told we're not getting the time back for interventions. Apologies for that, Mr Mara. The Post Office, the direct quote from the Lord Advocate to Parliament, the Post Office, its lawyers and UK government ministers ministers continued to support the Horizon system during 2013 to 2015, by which time we knew of the issues with the Horizon software, and that throughout the scandal there were worrying levels of deliberate and sustained concealment and deception. And it would be good to hear a general principle being put forward to say that any deception should be the subject of criminal investigation and, if necessary, criminal action, not just those against whom you've got disagreements. So the point I want to make today is the same point I made last week. Given those levels of deliberate concealment and deception, what is it going to take for the people responsible for the scandal in the first place, both in the UK government and in the Post Office, to face the consequences of their actions? The Post Office is answerable to UK ministers, and they're responsible for not taking action when the faults in the Horizon system were first identified. The UK government in all this has been posted missing as far as sub-postmasters in Scotland are concerned. And I believe it is the UK government's problem to fix. It would be a rare occasion I would stand here and say, why does the UK not legislate in Scottish affairs? But on this occasion, given the necessity of speed, and we heard from Beatrice Wishart the necessity to mirror as closely as possible the UK legislation, why do not ensure there's parity of treatment for everyone across the UK affected by this? Why does the UK government not include Scotland? Why do they include Northern Ireland, which is a different legal system, but they don't include Scotland? A very pertinent question. And I agree with Polly McNeill that we should make sure that the Crown Office and others are held accountable. I'm perfectly willing to accept that fact, but not that it should be something that delays the need for justice for the victims in all this. We know the UK government has broken the Sewell Convention 11 times since 2018, ignoring or overriding the wishes of this Parliament. And to me, that begs the question, if Scotland had done it first, would the UK have shut it down and told us to wait for the UK-wide legislation, as they have done in a number of other areas, like the deposit return scheme, which was shut down in order for a UK-wide scheme to take place, which, unsurprisingly, is yet to materialise? I, for one, cannot make sense of the UK government's decision-making in all of this. I'm glad that we're taking action to overturn the wrongful convictions here today. Now, I could be wrong and I'm willing to be corrected, but I am sure the Lord Advocate did not say, as has been alleged, that she does not support the idea of generalised pardons or whatever the relevant technology is. I'm sure she said that she could not do it within her powers and she was not willing to make comment on the collective responsibility position of the Scottish Government. But she said she couldn't do it, not that she wouldn't do it. But what is it going to take for the UK Government and the Post Office to be held to account here? Why did the UK Government, so keen to interfere in Scottish affairs, not include Scotland in this system? And I can't help but conclude that it's because the UK Government would rather play politics, as we're seeing from Murdo Fraser today, with the lives of people they've already let down severely in a cynical attempt to show this Parliament up and avert the blame for themselves. And the disgraceful way they talk about the Lord Advocate just shows there's a generalised attempt to discredit institutions in Scotland, part of a wider Tory platform. I think it's a disgrace. And in light of the UK Government's failure to act on behalf of the Scottish victims of this appalling scandal, I support the principles of the proportionate legislation which is now being proposed. I think it's also true to say that we should bear in mind the people that are victims. They're not unaware of where responsibility lies here and who's trying to get out from underneath it, who's not willing to take the action that's necessary. There is no logical conclusion other than the plain politics for the UK Government's actions in all of this. So I'm very pleased that the Scottish Government will take action. It's long overdue. People like Rab, my constituent, of course, have had their conviction overturned already, so I assume from what's been said in the debate he will now be eligible for that compensation. But it would be good to see that formalised for the other victims. And I think, and I don't know as much about Maggie Chapman's proposed further amendments, but they sound sensible to me. I hope they'll be given serious consideration by the Cabinet Secretary and the Government. But let's see if we can get this done as quickly as possible, given the UK Government's failure to act on behalf of the victims of this scandal.
Thank you, Mr Brown. I call Katie Clark to be followed by Fergus Ewing. Ms Clark.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This legislation, indeed the nature and tone of the Lord Advocate's statements to this Parliament, raise serious issues for the justice system in Scotland. As Murdo Fraser said earlier, we had a statement on the infected blood inquiry earlier today and heard representations about the culture in public bodies. The Law Society of Scotland says in its briefing to MSPs for this debate that it should be for the courts and not Parliament to quash convictions. That may indeed normally be the case, and it's extremely unfortunate that the Scottish courts and the Scottish justice system have failed to quash convictions on a case-by-case basis before now. We do need to identify what has gone wrong here, because it's clear that there were concerns within the Crown Office in 2013 that the Horizon evidence was not safe. There's been a number of references in this debate already today to that 2013 meeting and indeed to the Alan Bates legal cases thereafter. So whilst it is a pleasure to be able to speak in this important debate and support steps to ensure that those convicted by the Horizon scandal have their wrongful convictions overturned now and indeed compensation as soon as possible, it is the role of this Parliament to seriously grapple with why there has been such delays in that happening. I appreciate that this bill is deliberately drafted to mirror the Post Office Horizon System Offences Bill, the Westminster legislation. This Parliament, yes, needs to ensure that all of those wrongly convicted, wrongly prosecuted and wrongly convicted receive justice. But we also need to look at what went wrong here. Around 100 people are believed to have been wrongly convicted in Scotland, and it's hugely concerning that in Scotland, like the rest of the UK, prosecutions proceeded when there was so much concern that there were problems with this system. I will talk about my own personal experience, because I was an MP at Westminster prior to 2015, and whilst to my knowledge I did not have any constituent in North Ayrshire and Arran directly affected in this issue, I attended a number of meetings at the House of Commons in the year prior to 2015, organised by sub-postmasters and mistresses, and they were attended by people who had been falsely accused from across the UK who explained what had happened to them. They were large meetings with MPs from all political parties and indeed from campaigners from across the UK, and there was consensus from MPs from across the political spectrum and robust representations raising the concerns that were being raised. Many lives we know were destroyed because those voices were not listened to, and we need to understand as a Parliament why it is that it required a TV programme for the justice system to respond. At this time that I was learning about this in the years up to 2015, it simply didn't seem credible that these were prosecutions that were safe. Many professionals involved in the cases were raising concerns based on what they were seeing. But the fact that many law-abiding citizens were being accused and were being prosecuted and indeed were being convicted due to problems with a computer system didn't seem to be recognised by the system. And I think that's what we need to focus on. I took part in a debate in the House of Commons on this issue in 2014 and indeed was on the committee, the Business Innovation and Skills Select Committee, that took evidence in the early part of 2015. And it was clear in the debates that were taking place in 2013 that MPs across the political spectrum were concerned. But in my own speech, I made specific reference to my role as the chair of the Communication Workers Union in Parliament and indeed the discussions that I'd been having with their sub-postmasters branch in that capacity. Because what was very clear and was made very clear in the debates, it wasn't just the people that were being prosecuted that were raising concerns. There were concerns being raised across post offices, across the UK. And what was being said very clearly was the experience of those directly affected was that when a problem was occurring in relation to financial systems within the post office, the initial response from the post office was to blame the postmaster or mistress rather than to conduct a serious inquiry to see whether there had been a fault in the system or to find out what had been going wrong. We know that the consequences of that were devastating for individuals, whether they proceeded through the criminal courts or not. And we have many, many examples of years of anguish as a result. So as a Parliament, yes, we need to pass this legislation. We need to make sure that everybody that was affected, that was taken through the criminal courts, is included, and that may require some amendments to come forward that may not mirror what's happened at Westminster. I hope that the Scottish Government will look favourably on that, because we need to make sure those convictions are squashed. But there are broader issues here, not just for those that were prosecuted, but those that were accused that never led to prosecutions, but also broader issues, I believe, in terms of what we do when serious concerns are being raised in public institutions and how the state responds.
Thank you, Ms Clark. I now call Fergus Ewing to be followed by Jamie Green. Mr Ewing.
Presiding Officer, this is what Kenneth Donnelly, Deputy Crown Agent at the Crown Office, told Wynne Williams' inquiry about the appeals raised in Scotland to the Court of Criminal Appeal. Following conclusion of the first tranche of appeals, it's anticipated a streamlined and expedient process of review, appeal and disposal will be available for application to any future cases. It's anticipated the rate of review and appeal will therefore increase exponentially. It's not possible at this stage to provide a timescale for this process to be completed. Delivered last November. What's happened to that? Where is it? And why, in any event, wasn't it brought forward at the very latest in 2015, and perhaps even earlier? Presiding Officer, I've been a solicitor and a member of the Law Society for 43 years. I've got great respect for them, and I agree in principle that we should not transgress the separation of powers. It is for the courts to administer justice. It is for us to pass the laws and steer clear of being involved indirectly in cases. But in this case, I'm afraid our legal system has just completely let us down. And there's no escaping from that conclusion. So we have to pass this bill, we have to get it right, and there's lots of problems with it, not least of which, and this hasn't been mentioned, is that I noticed just yesterday, reading the financial memorandum, paragraph 35, that up till now I thought there was about 80 or 100 cases. Every time the Lord Advocate has opined about the number of cases, she's mentioned a figure of around 80 or 100. But what does paragraph 35 of the financial memorandum say? It says there's a low estimate of cases to be reviewed of 1,000, or a high estimate of cases to be reviewed of 2,000. Cabinet Secretary, I think we've got some work to do here to find out what exactly is the explanation for that enormous discrepancy. There may be a simple answer, but here we are at stage one and we've got no inkling, presiding officer, of the answer. I'll give way to the Cabinet Secretary.
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm grateful to Mr Ewing, presiding officer. Can I just clarify that the explanatory notes and the financial memorandum says that the best estimate of cases to be quashed is 200. It could be lower, it could be higher. But to ensure that we capture everyone who's suffered a miscarriage of justice, we will indeed need to look at between 1,000 and 2,000 cases if we are going to be satisfied that justice is going to be served.
Fergus Ewing.
Well, I absolutely agree with that, but the question I ask is, why are we only finding out about this much higher possible figure now? We didn't hear about it in January, and we didn't hear about it last week from the Lord Advocate. Well, the officer, the victims have been betrayed not just once, not just twice, but at least thrice. Firstly, by being wrongly convicted. Secondly, by the cover-up, the venal, the deceitful, the illegal, the bullying, the Stasi-like behaviour of those acting on behalf of the Post Office. But thirdly, by the failure of the Scottish system, of which I and other solicitors here are proud to have been part of for all my adult life, to be a truly effective, independent prosecutorial system. The Crown were, as is they admit, and they were forced to admit it, incidentally. They didn't come clean. They were forced to admit it by an FOI from the BBC and by having to give evidence to the Wynne Williams inquiry. If it hadn't been for those things, we may be none the wiser. This may have been completely covered up. But they were told in 2013 at two meetings that the Horizon system was apparently flawed, and their first reaction was to say, let's terminate the policy. That, I think, must have been the right one. But they were persuaded, we don't quite know why, to do otherwise. But at the end of the second meeting in September, they were promised that Carter Knight, the solicitors for the Post Office, would carry out, quotes, a full examination of all Horizon cases. Now, if that was said at September, wasn't there somebody in the Crown Office shrewd enough to say, well, hang on, if everything is fine with Horizon, Why is it we need a full examination? Surely that's inconsistent with a bland assurance that all is well and that there are no dodgy cases. And moreover, as Polly McNeill was asked, why didn't they pick up the phone to Second Sight or Helen Rose? Did they? We don't really know. Did they make any inquiries whatsoever, as our independent investigators of a system of which I up till now, I was fairly proud? And thirdly, I mean, you know, it's not exactly a huge shock to many of us that computers don't always work very well. I mean, my goodness me, I was Cabinet Secretary for Rural. I spent 2 years of my life involved in minutiae of trying to fix a dud computer system. and in any event, which computer system is so intelligent that it can detect when it is being operated north of Hadrian's Wall? That's a thing, isn't it? Did any of the people in the Crown Office ask any questions about that? And moreover, since there were so many sub-postmasters and mistresses that were being charged, didn't somebody in the Crown Office say, hang on, these must be amongst the most law-abiding people in the country? How come there's this sudden flood of crooks that are running sub-post offices? I mean, the whole thing just looks to me utterly, utterly incredible. And the first duty we have is to the victims and get compensation. I support the Cabinet Secretary about that. But in conclusion, Presiding Officer, we must know what happened. The Crown Office must come clean. They have to voluntarily give us a full, thorough and credible account of what happened. And until they do, this won't go away. And I think that would do the reputation of the Crown Office no good whatsoever.
Thank you, Mr Ewing. I now call Jamie Green to be followed by Audrey Nicholl. Mr Green.
Thank you. I think it's really telling that the content of Chamber Business today is consumed by two great national scandals, the infected blood scandal and the post office scandal. And I don't think we really know for certain how many people have been impacted by the latter. But like the former, people had their lives absolutely ruined by these institutions. Institutions which demanded trust and respect whilst forfeiting the very trust in the individuals who relied on them and who made them successful in the first place. Because ultimately innocent people were wrongly accused of malpractice and crime. Innocent people were thrust into debt and financial devastation, and innocent people lost their own lives. And all in the name of protecting this great institution, but more importantly, the people in charge of it at the time. That is about as bad as it gets. Innocent people, like we've already heard, Keith McIldowie, a sub-postmaster from Greenock, falsely accused of theft to the tune of 15 grand, desperately taking loans from his family, from anywhere he could get money, just to balance the books, just to balance the Horizon books, the Horizon hellhole that he found himself in. He lost his marriage, his friends, his money. He was ostracised by the very community which he served diligently. He was forced with the choice to resign or be prosecuted. Well, which would you choose? And in his evidence to the UK Horizon Inquiry, and this is what made this thing so real to me, he said this: the impact of the post office has affected my life in every aspect. I have been treated as the guilty party. I came close to suicide. At one point, I had a noose around my neck. Can you imagine what that feels like? So this debate is for them, not for the politics of others. Because after months of ambiguity, this bill goes about as far as it can in terms of mass exoneration. It's not a perfect solution, and nor will it serve any justice to people like Keith and so many others. But seeing governments and parliaments legislate to quash decisions made by the court should make us uncomfortable as legislators, but it should also make the Crown uncomfortable as well. Yes, there might be exceptional circumstances. Yes, this bill is not perfect. For example, the issue of when a conviction had already been appealed before the High Court and was refused, the bill will not quash those convictions. The Lord Advocate confirmed that that may not affect too many people, but as we've already heard, it may do. The UK Government Bill faces a very similar conundrum. It will not quash convictions where appeals have been rejected by the Court of Appeal. But the UK Government have instead insisted that they will consider these cases on a case-by-case basis. And I hope the same is true here in Scotland, because no victim of the scandal can be left behind. Parity between Scottish postmasters and anybody else in the UK affected by this scandal is necessary on a moral level, if nothing else, even if it presents technical difficulties in doing so. The Cabinet Secretary's letter to the Justice Committee today referenced the timescales for Stage 3. My view is that we should legislate fully this side of summer recess, and if any future UK bill presents or necessitates change, then we mop those up over the summer recess, not the other way round. And why do I say so? Because we need to be seen to be acting proactively here, because the Crown, right here in Scotland, took and made decisions to prosecute Scottish postmasters. And it's that very difference of law and difference of process which is what makes all this more disgraceful here in Scotland. Because arguably our legal system could or should offer a safety net in the way that the Post Office cases prosecuted elsewhere did not. In fact, our very prized and unique approach to prosecuting and of corroboration should have led to that, but it didn't. Why? Because the Crown trusted the Post Office, seemingly beyond doubt, naively, conveniently, perhaps we will never know, perhaps we should know. And with respect to the Lord Advocate, when I asked her last week, why so? Her prescripted response disappointed not just me, but those victims of this, because she implied it's not the job of the Crown to challenge evidence. Well, perhaps not. But in the absence of a robust police investigation, in the absence of well-paid defence lawyers on the side of the postmasters, was it not more than necessary than ever for the Crown to be utterly confident in its decision to prosecute cases? And I'd say the Lord Advocate has endured two very uncomfortable and perhaps unenlightening appearances in this chamber already this year. Of course, yes, the Post Office has lost its status as a specialist reporting agency, rightly so, but there do remain far too many unanswered questions as to why the Crown accepted Post Office evidence at face value without query and without questions. And even when suspicions arose, and we've heard documentation of that today, those prosecutions proceeded. Why? Now, referring crime to the police instead is not watertight. Anyone who saw the BBC Disclosure documentary will have seen the horrendous case of the late Karen Lorimer, who, when interviewed by the police, told her of, I quote, important people who, and this was the words of the police, worked for the Post Office for years. They know the Horizon system upside down, back to front, inside out. It's completely and utterly foolproof. They've all done their checks. The money is simply not there, she was told. That is the real-life plot of a TV drama. Legislation will never undo the trust lost in our justice system. It will never undo the trust lost in the Post Office, or even politicians' ability or inability to hold all of them to account. Now, the blood scandal compensation promises to compensate those, I quote, infected and affected by that horrendous scandal. So to all the victims, convicted or not, of this scandal, they deserve more than warm words and 11-page bills. They deserve compensation, every single one of them, because anything less is morally repugnant, in my view.
Thank you, Mr Green. I now call Audrey Nicholl to be followed by Claire Adamson. Ms Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Like other members, I welcome the Post Office Horizon System Offences Scotland Bill being considered at Stage 1 today. The bill, like the Post Office Offences Bill being taken forward in the UK Parliament in respect of convictions in England and Wales, takes the unprecedented and wholly exceptional step of providing a blanket exoneration for all those affected. Now, we all have memories of that familiar feature in our high streets across Scotland, the post office, selling stamps, paying out pensions and benefits, posting off our parcels and Christmas cards. So it makes it all the more hard to believe, and frankly sinister, that the installation of the software upgrade to the post office accounting system, Horizon, that aimed to reduce fraud in local post office branches, became the focus of one of the most significant frauds on justice in our legal history. And I extend my support to every individual who suffered the trauma, indignity and humiliation of being prosecuted and convicted of a crime they did not commit. Victimised by a horrific injustice unleashed on people who'd done nothing wrong, robbing postmasters and their families of their livelihood, well-being, their good names, and their right to having a good life, and all at the hands of a greedy, reckless, corporation. Now, we know many people who have suffered these injustices have not come forward, and I understand the conflict many feel at the prospect of reopening and reliving a traumatic and very difficult set of memories. Not everyone who was wrongly accused by the Horizon IT system is still with us, and I welcome the proposals in the bill for these individuals to have the wrong that they suffered addressed. Many of us will have heard constituents, friends or even family members speak movingly about the devastating impact the Horizon system had on them. In my case, a colleague whose father was a postmaster recently reflected, "I remember as a boy, every week, my father would say to my mum, 'I can't understand it, the takings are short again.' For years, my dad would check and double check, and if the till was short, he would top it up from his own pocket. It would not be a stretch to anticipate my colleague's father paid many thousands of pounds back to the post office, assuming the fault was his, never questioning the integrity of Horizon. I commend the work of the Criminal Cases Review Commission in considering Post Office Horizon convictions to date, referring around 76 such convictions to the appeal courts, resulting in 63 convictions being overturned. And those figures I took today from the CCRC website. I'll give way to Mr.
Russell Finlay.
Thank you. I just wonder if the member shares my curiosity as to how the Crown Office and the Scottish Criminal Cases Review Commission arrived at the number of 73 convictions in light of the suggestion that there could be up to 2,000.
Audrey Nicholl.
I can't answer that question, and I thank Mr. Finlay for raising it, but I hope that the bill and subsequent act will seek to address some of that. Now, I have spent most of my working life immersed in the criminal justice system, reporting many serious and complex criminal cases, giving evidence in sheriff courts and the High Court. And so I commend the commitment and professionalism of those working across the criminal justice system, including our courts, to seek justice for those wronged by crime and to hold those responsible to account. But I am not insensitive to the concerns raised by members around prosecutions in Scotland. But today's debate revolves around a bill that seeks to bring redress to those whose lives have been devastated, and to do so timeously. Now, given the failings of the Horizon IT system that lies at the heart of this matter, I am fully supportive of the exceptional steps being taken in the bill to exonerate post office postmasters convicted using information which infected the process of justice, with individuals pleading guilty to or being found guilty of offences that they did not commit. But it is disappointing that, despite representation from the Scottish Government, the UK Government has chosen not to extend their bill to Scotland. And frankly, if I was a Horizon victim, I'm not sure what message I would take from that. Presiding Officer, in the numerous media reports highlighting specific injustices, it's become clear that there is a requirement for a broad range of provisions to be included in the bill that captured the breadth of individual circumstances faced by individual postmasters. And I also welcome the provisions of the bill which seek to expunge any record of wrongdoing by those affected. A range of crimes of dishonesty have been prosecuted, and consequently, the range of penalties which have been imposed are addressed in the bill. I do realise that, given the time which has elapsed for some of those impacted by these events, the removal of a wrongful conviction may be of limited practical effect, given issues such as previous convictions may not be eligible to be tendered in a court after all this time. However, it is important that we right the wrongs which the Horizon IT system created insofar as is possible. And importantly, the bill sets out to, where possible, undo the many additional wrongs which have flowed from these miscarriages of justice. And these will include the repayment of fines and addressing the impact of pensions entitlements for those who were wrongly imprisoned. So, Presiding Officer, in conclusion, we do not have the power to turn back time or remove the hurt and anger of those wrongly accused. We do have the power, however, and the responsibility to stand up for those wronged, to publicly declare the wrongdoing, and as far as possible help them find the place they would have been in their lives but for this injustice. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Nicol. I now call Claire Adamson to be followed by Michael Mara. Ms Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I think it's not often that we have an issue that unifies most of the Chamber and the public in an agreement when it comes to the outcome of this particular issue. But everyone is united to see justice for people who have their lives and livelihoods ruined by one of the greatest miscarriages of justice in modern history. In many respects, we must be realistic. The damage has been done, and sub-monsters and their families were put through hell. It was systemic abdication of responsibility for those involved. And while we can make redress and we can do what we can with this bill to quash convictions that were not sound, that we will never be able to fully compensate for what has happened to postmasters across the country. So I'm heartened that the Parliament has taken this unprecedented step in bringing this emergency bill, and it speaks to the severity of the issue. It's deemed necessary. Many will have waited years, if not decades, to get to this point, and tragically some will not see those wrongs righted. Consecutive UK governments, as the sole shareholder in Post Office Limited, allowed the Horizon scandal to happen unabated. The Post Office were complicit in attempts to conceal these issues from public, and Fujitsu, who I believe remain conspicuously absent from these discussions, must do more to account for their responsibility. Innocent people were caught in the crossfire of institutional systemic failure. And while there is consensus for redressing these historic wrongs, I want to pay tribute to my Motherwell and Wishaw colleague Marion Fellows for her resolute advocacy for sub-postmasters in Westminster over many, many years in the all-party APPG at Westminster on postmasters, along with many colleagues from across the political spectrum. I want to pay tribute to the journalists at Computer Weekly. I probably stand alone as one of the few people in this place that actually has a subscription to Computer Weekly as a former computing professional myself. But we know that how important that research work and their response to the complaints of Mr Bates were in bringing this to the fore. And our tributes must go to the campaigners who fought tirelessly against one of the UK's oldest and most recognisable institutions with the odds stacked against them. They took on the system and they have beaten it. We legislators now know the truth because of their efforts, and we have a moral duty to act now. Many will question why it took a TV drama to shift the dial in this, and that should not be the focus of our discourse today, but it does raise questions for us all on what attention we paid to the warnings that were there previously. Our collective focus should be on expediting the bill so that the equity can be finally secured for Scottish sub-postmasters. I have to say, though, I am disappointed that the opportunity to include Scottish postmasters wasn't taken up by the Westminster Government. Indeed, my colleague Marion Fellows moved an amendment to the bill at Westminster that would have effectively put that in place.
Russell,
I'll take an intervention. Mr
Finlay.
Thank you. I just wonder in that regard whether the member accepts the need for Scottish legislation as laid out by the Cabinet Secretary, not least because of the specific Scottish criminal offences.
Claire Adamson.
Well, that same argument could be given for Northern Ireland, but after that bill was passed, they then came back and included Northern Ireland, so why not include Scotland? And it leaves a question in Scottish sub-postmasters. It leaves a doubt in those affected. And I tell you why that is so important, because there is a group of people we're not talking about today in the context of the bill who have been affected by those sub-masters who signed non-disclosure agreements, gave up their business under the same bullying tactics of the post office, gave up contractual payments that they would have received on doing that normally at the end of their term as a postmaster, in order to make this problem go away. And some of those postmasters have paid tens of thousands of pounds to make good these balances with the post office. Their lives have been affected in the same way, and because of the non-criminal prosecution, they remain very, very sceptical about coming forward at this stage to have their own case brought forward, to be in the public eye, to have that exposed at this time. They are very, very fearful. And a blanket ban across the UK, I think, would have done some good in assuring those people, because Wynne Williams did give the assurance during the inquiry that the NDAs would not be acted on. But the Scottish sub-postmasters are asking, does that apply in Scotland? We have a different legal system. And if there's anything the Cabinet Secretary does to bring some clarity to that situation for those sub-postmasters going forward, I would be really grateful to know that. But this is about the confidence of those to come forward, and we should have been doing everything we can to make it as easy as possible for those who have been convicted and also those who have been bullied and coerced into giving up their businesses using the same evidence and the same tactics from the post office to come forward and seek redress. And I hope that some of the conversations that we have going forward when we pass this bill will encourage more people to come forward and get the redress that they deserve.
Thank you, Ms Adamson. I now call Michael Mara to be followed by Alistair Allen. Mr Mara.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Horizon scandal is a very great miscarriage of justice. Reputations ruined, livelihoods laid waste to, dignity destroyed and lives lost. Many went to their graves knowing that they had been wronged without hope of clearing their name. While this legislation will not undo the pain, shame and suffering caused, it is right that we legislate to deliver justice, however belatedly, and that wrongly convicted sub-postmasters and sub-postmistresses be exonerated. The bill itself is relatively straightforward, as it is to a very, very large extent. It exactly mirrors the UK legislation. I have to say, I find the posturing of recent weeks and, frankly, some of this afternoon to be genuinely inexplicable. The bill in front of us is proof that the impossibilist claims of the SNP government were without foundation. And the situation in Scotland is distinct, and the Cabinet Secretary knows this. In the case of the Horizon scandal, it was the Crown Office who prosecuted in Scotland, as opposed to the Post Office in England and Wales. The circumstances are materially different. It is right that we legislate here with diligence and with speed. In doing so, we will also... certainly.
Clear Adamson.
I'm sorry that the member has taken that this is posturing. At the time of the delay, could I draw his attention to the evidence from James Chalmers, Regius Professor of Law at the University of Glasgow, to the Justice Select Committee in Westminster on the 16th of April. He said, requiring the Scottish Government to wait and see how legislation passes through the Parliament and how it is amended so as to try and mirror it at a later time seems to help no one. This was not necessary.
Michael Mara.
I thank the member for the intervention. I have to say that the bill in front of us proves that we can do it here and, frankly, that we should do it here. And I would say on the basis of the fact that the institutions are different, and it's right that we as parliamentarians have the opportunity to hold those institutions to account, asking specific questions about the conduct that took place, including from members of the members' own party who are raising very specific issues. Without that legislation in front of us now, we would not have that opportunity. So it's an ancillary benefit, but I believe a very important one. But the Horizon scandal has struck a profound chord with many across our nation. Firstly, it's because it's about as clear a demonstration of injustice as you can possibly find, accused of a crime you did not commit and devastatingly punished for it. Secondly, because it confirms a fear that many ordinary people have, that great institutions will always protect themselves, not the people they are meant to serve. And those fears are well founded. The Bishop of Liverpool's 2017 report into the Hillsborough disaster was titled "The Patronising Disposition of Unaccountable Power." That sentiment is echoed in the Post Office's interaction with the Crown Office in Scotland, repeated reassurances about the accuracy of the Horizon system, which have since been exposed as utterly false. A part of that unaccountable power of the Post Office stems from its role as a specialist reporting agency. The Lord Advocate is right to strip the Post Office of that status. But I do think this Parliament should hear more as to the specific rationale for that decision, with which I agree, though I believe for differing reasons as the limited evidence being set out so far. Is it the grievous nature of the offence, Presiding Officer? Is this vital piece of national infrastructure, a postal service, inherently untrustworthy? Or was it the people who ran it? Is the profit motives of a privatised utility incompatible with the status? Because many more such companies remain listed as specialist reporting agencies. Because I do remain concerned as to how the standards and other specialist reporting agencies will be enforced. Exactly the kind of questions this Parliament should have the opportunity to ask. The Lord Advocate stated that work is underway to strengthen the guidance and safeguards that exist, and it's right that the Parliament is kept up to date on that work. So on the 16th of January, the Lord Advocate said there has to be a system of reporting and a system by which the Crown Prosecution Service in Scotland can rely on successful government agencies with established reputations as its specialist reporting agencies. Established reputations is key here, and many are long established, enjoying this status for hundreds of years. We're debating the general principles of this bill mere minutes after the First Minister's response to the Infected Blood Inquiry report. And he said, we cannot have this culture in our public institutions. A vital reminder that we cannot blindly put our faith in the organisations. The establishment is trusted. It protects itself and the power structures that it relies upon. Those of us on the left may attribute more weight to this as a function of inequality, the imbalance of power between those with status and those without all, depending on the money in your pocket and the clothes you wear. Liberals and Tories will point to the imbalance of the state and the citizen, where unbending bureaucracy too often trumps dignity. In truth, there is little more than fine differences of perspective when it comes to the experience of citizens. There must always be the necessary checks and balances in our politics. We have to redouble our support for whistleblowers, for the honest people who refuse to look the other way or to back down. These are the power of stories, the provocation of public empathy, the witness borne by literature, theatre, television, where art becomes a mirror that reveals all of us in unsightly relief. Hillsborough, Bloody Sunday, the institutional child abuse, El Jamel. We are decades past the age of deference, and we are not now only reaping its consequence. Each day we seed more scandal, and on it goes. It begs the question, Presiding Officer, of all of us, as to whether these are historical wrongs or a structural tenet of our state. There remains today a culture of institutional cover-up that blights Scotland. Is the way we operate this state fit to prevent injustice in our age, a task which it is daily proven to have been incapable of in decades and centuries past?
Thank you, Mr Mara. And I now call Alistair Allen. Dr Allen.
Presiding Officer, as we have heard from others today, thousands of innocent sub-postmasters have had their lives ruined by being wrongly convicted of offences of dishonesty on the evidence of the faulty Post Office Horizon system. I'm very glad that the bill's passage through the Scottish Parliament will be expedited to allow justice and redress to be delivered to victims as swiftly as possible. Of course, as others have pointed out, the quickest, easiest route to overturn these miscarriages of justice would have been for the UK Government to have extended their own bill to cover sub-postmasters in Scotland. Unfortunately, the Scottish Government's repeated requests for this were refused. Nonetheless, looking forward, this bill set before us today should serve both symbolic and practical purposes under the overturned conviction scheme established by the UK Government. Anyone who was wrongfully convicted as a result of Horizon evidence is eligible to receive compensation of at least £600,000, but only once their conviction has been overturned. However, Presiding Officer, many of those who have previously had their wrongful convictions overturned, including a constituent of mine, have yet to receive a penny in compensation. Presiding Officer, as her case is in the public domain already, I will, with her permission, take this opportunity to mention my constituent, Anne Quorn, whom I have been supporting in this matter. Mrs Quorn's late husband, William, was a sub-postmaster in North Uist. It was around 2009 that Mr Quarren, who had run his sub-post office for several years, highlighted to the post office that he was experiencing issues with the newly installed Horizon IT system. The post office claimed that large sums of money were missing from the end-of-day accounts, a discrepancy which Mr Quarren could not understand. Due to what we all now know were fundamental problems with Horizon, Mr Quarren was initially ordered to pay tens of thousands of pounds. He tried to comply, but simply could not keep up. Visiting investigators from the post office told Mr Quarren, as they of course claimed to everyone else in this story, that nobody else in the country was having any issues with the Horizon system except him. It has since become very clear that these investigators were incompetent, largely untrained, and were telling what now seemed to have very clearly been untruths. Mr and Mrs Quarren were prosecuted on the strength of evidence provided by the post office and had their sub-post office taken from them. The attached family-run shop also had to be sold. They lost their family home, much of their croft, and their small bed and breakfast business. They soon became insolvent as a result. Mr Quorum's health quickly deteriorated, leaving Mrs Quorum having to plead for her husband to be allowed to spend his final days in his own home, ahead of that home having to be disposed of. Despite working for the post office for 14 years, it was also decided that Mr and Mrs Quorum should not have anything paid out to them from Mr Quorum's pension. This decision has, incredibly, never been corrected. Mr Quarren sadly died 2 years after being prosecuted on the strength of evidence provided by the post office. Aside from their financial losses, they both suffered enormous levels of stress at a time when Mr Quarren was already seriously ill. To this must be added the strain for Mrs Quarren of trying to contain the details of her situation in a small island community where the stigma associated with any prosecution is very significant indeed. This couple, who were liked and well-respected, were left completely shattered. Today, Mrs Quarren is living in rented accommodation and is having to work full-time at a point when she should really be thinking of retirement. Mr and Mrs Quarren were eventually exonerated by a court of all the crimes of which the post office accused them, though unfortunately this came well after Mr Quarren's death. To date, Mrs Quarren has not received a penny of compensation. Although I do understand that the post office did offer to make an interim payment, this is yet to be seen, and there is still no sign of these payments ever being processed. At no stage has the post office or the UK government, the sole shareholder in the post office, offered any support whatsoever, and the family have had to defend themselves at their own expense. Presiding officer, I am sure members will agree that Mrs Quarren and her late husband have been treated shamefully by an organisation in whom the UK government is, as I say, the sole shareholder. I wrote to Kevin Hollenrake MP, the UK Minister for Enterprise, Markets and Small Business, on the 26th of February on Mrs Quarren's behalf, and I have written twice again since. I have received no reply from him, far less any indication of what has become of any interim payment, any compensation or even Mrs Quarren's pension. I hope I do get a reply sometime, presiding officer. I think you'll agree that Mrs Quarren deserves this, at the very least.
Thank you. We move to winding up speeches, and I call on Maggie Chapman, up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, presiding officer. And I thank all of those who have told the stories of their constituents and community members who have been affected by this scandal. Because it is these people, the victims and survivors of this gross miscarriage of justice, and their families, who must be at the forefront of our minds as we consider this legislation this week. It is these people and the horrific experiences that they have been through that must be in our minds as we work to ensure they receive effective compensation and redress, and to support them to do so. It is also these people that must be central as we learn the lessons of the scandal about our justice system, about our culture around corporate power, and about our treatment of those who raise concerns about systems and processes that affect and control their lives. Because innocent people lost their lives. Innocent people were convicted of crimes that didn't even exist. Innocent people have suffered financial distress, emotional trauma, and so much more, because of failure within both the public and private sectors. So we have some hard work to do to renew the trust that they will have lost, to renew that trust not only in institutions like the Post Office and in the technology that so many of us rely on, but, and in many ways more fundamentally, trust in our justice system and our politics. Of course, part of rebuilding trust is to enable better understanding of the responsibilities of private and public agencies. I have spoken this afternoon already, as have others, about the dangers of the privatisation and corporatisation of vital services and utilities. We must work, too, on improving the accountability of the institutions involved, and as a consequence, accountability for the decisions we make as politicians, because we set the frameworks within most, maybe not all, but most others function. So I have been heartened to see this afternoon the extent of consensus across the Parliament. Consensus on the urgency of this bill, the need to ensure that it is comprehensive, and the desire to address the causes as well as the consequences of this appalling injustice. From a constitutional point of view, and I'm speaking of the constitutional issue that is actually of relevance to us today, of course, it is deeply regrettable that we need to have legislation to overturn court judgments. It is a sign not of the breakdown of the principle of the separation of powers, but of the extraordinary scale upon which this miscarriage of justice was allowed to occur. It is important to recognise that this kind of legislation is exceptional and should not be the norm. But it is equally important to recognise that in these extraordinary, exceptional circumstances, it is the right thing to do. This bill is not a rubber-stamping exercise mirroring UK legislation exactly, and neither will the final act be a direct copy. The UK government was asked to legislate for Scotland and chose not to, so we must therefore take our responsibility seriously and, as I said in my opening speech, make this law as robust, inclusive and effective as possible. Our debates this afternoon and the follow-up debate on Thursday will give us the opportunity to expand on that, to do that together. And I trust that the same spirit of cooperation and joint endeavour will characterise those discussions we have in 2 days' time. Because it is for the people affected by this miscarriage of justice that we speak this week. It is for them that we seek not only to quash the convictions that they should never have faced, but to ensure that we get compensation and redress. It is for them that we seek justice. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call on Pauline McNeill, up to 7 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, the chain of wrongdoing we've been discussing this afternoon is a wide chain indeed. It goes beyond the Post Office, because it does include those officials and engineers in Fujitsu who knew that they were abusing the system to get balances to balance. James Arbuthnot played a pivotal role in helping sub-postmasters achieve justice. He never gave up. He was never brushed off, and Katie Clark and other MPs at the time were very well aware of the controversy. Why were others not aware of this? Fergus Ewing and Jamie Green are quite correct to say that lessons need to be learned. And why would hundreds of otherwise law-abiding people running small businesses up and down the country, who were figures in their own communities, helping people with their pensions, savings and benefits, as Alistair Allen has highlighted, the very role that they played in their communities was the very role that hurt them because of this unlawful scandal. These postmasters signed contracts to make good any losses. Why would 800 or so of them defraud themselves of thousands of pounds and knowing that they would face criminal proceedings? It doesn't actually make a great deal of sense. And even the helpline that was set up to help sub-postmasters deal with the Horizon computer system was said to be an utter nightmare, holding on for hours at end just when they were trying to learn how to use the system when they couldn't get the money to balance. That was a telltale sign in itself. I'll give way to Jamie Green.
Jamie Green.
I'm very grateful. One of the things that I'd never really understood is why no one in any of these institutions, and that includes the Crown itself, was not questioning why a sudden onslaught of referrals from the post office, of all these small businesses suddenly defrauding the entire system at our tens of thousands of pounds on a daily basis, apparently, why that never, ever rang any alarm bells in any of these institutions, and yet they proceeded with prosecutions.
Well, Jamie Green is quite correct. I mean, that's why Scottish Labour believes that we need answers to these questions, which is why we should be debating it here in Scotland and the legislation should be dealt with here in Scotland. The system that was set up to help sub-postmasters run an efficient system was the one that wrongly criminalised them. So Maggie Chapman is right that Parliament has to act. Both parliaments have to act here with emergency legislation. But I think it will require considerable effort to capture all the convicted sub-postmasters who were wrongfully convicted. And I believe at that point, we did know in 2019 that there were unsafe convictions on the back of the court case. And I do wonder if the Scottish Government raised any questions in 2019 about what actions should have been taken following that court case as to ensure that convictions in Scotland that were unsafe, given the discussion we've had about the duty of disclosure. I don't think the Cabinet Secretary could deal with that. I know that she wasn't in post at the time, but I think it's a pertinent question to ask. The emergency bill will be very important, but it's useful to understand how many people may benefit and what pipeline of cases do exist. I just want to mention, lastly, a case I did mention to the Cabinet Secretary of Ravinder Singh Naja, who pled guilty when he was innocent. The post office was ordered shut in 2009 and is still shut. And he appeared along with his mother. He wasn't employed in the post office. He helped his mother in his spare time. But he pled guilty, even though he was innocent, in order to save his mother, was given a community sentence. He sadly contracted tuberculosis and almost died. But he is as much a victim as anyone else. And I plead with the Scottish Government to consider how we could amend this bill to ensure that he is covered by this legislation. I think in conclusion, Presiding Officer, I think it would be helpful if we work together on this, share with each other as early as possible all the amendments, because we want Thursday to go smoothly. But Michael Mara and Katie Clark are absolutely right. The institutional cover-up, the lies, the deceit, not just by one official, but several of the top brass within the post office. The star witness is appearing tomorrow for the next 3 days. This scandal will be even deeper than it is right now. And Alistair Allen highlights the compensation failures. This must be done, and rightly so. That should be done as a UK bill, and Scottish Labour supports that. Let's work together to make sure this never happens again. Let's get this bill right, make sure these convictions are overturned, and that we track down as many as possible of the people who can benefit from this emergency legislation.
Thank you, and I call on Sharon Dowie. Up to 8 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The issue at stake today demands urgent attention and action from everybody here in the Scottish Parliament. Every party must put politics to one side and focus only on delivering for the victims of this scandal and their families. There were many excellent contributions today that will highlight, which rightly emphasised, the gravity and the importance of this legislation. We must get this right, and we must do it quickly. Across the chamber, speeches today got to the heart of the tragedy that unfolded over many years when the post office wrongly went after sub-postmasters based on a faulty system. And as Pauline McNeill mentioned, I think we need to question the role of Fujitsu in this. Many colleagues spoke movingly about the damage and the ruin that devastated the lives of so many innocent people. And Alistair Allen spoke of the devastating case of his constituents, Mr and Mrs Quirn. There are few topics that provoke such a strong cross-party response as the horrendous mass miscarriage of justice which happened in this instance. I want to highlight the powerful contribution from Russell Findlay, who quoted the families of victims who sadly lost their lives before their name was cleared. He mentioned a number of cases of those wrongly accused and those who took their own lives. I cannot imagine the grief and despondency these people felt passing away with a guilty verdict against their name when they had done absolutely nothing wrong. Yet they had no means at their disposal to prove that they were good and honest people. I also felt Ruth Maguire made a very emotional point about the impact on people's mental and physical health from being embroiled in this horrific turn of events. Lives were turned upside down in ways that cannot ever be rectified. The toll this took in their health cannot be calculated. And I want to pay tribute to all those people who kept going and somehow stayed strong in the face of this terrible miscarriage of justice. Murdo Fraser spoke movingly about the fact that sub-postmasters were often some of the most well-thought-of people in their community. They were considered honourable, decent, honest, moral and reliable. But they were told they could not challenge the Horizon evidence. They pleaded guilty to charges they were innocent of. It's particularly tragic that this scandal wrecked the lives of this group of people. They were branded criminals and outcasts of society when they were the exact opposite. Jamie Green spoke about the consequences of the financial ruin that victims suffered. They were told to resign or be prosecuted. Who knows how many lives this has affected, even beyond the victims themselves. A number of young people will have grown up in very different circumstances because their parents were wrongfully convicted. That is one of the many heartbreaking aspects of this whole affair. Across the chamber today, Katie Clark and others asked the same question pointedly. Why has this taken so long? And why did it take a programme, Mr Bates versus the Post Office, to get things moving? That's a question we should all keep asking ourselves, and every party should reflect on that. I thought Pauline McNeill made a particularly strong speech focusing on the inability of politicians and the legal system to correct the grotesque injustice earlier. Why did they not question it? Computer Weekly, writing an article as far back as 2009. Why were alarm bells not ringing then? Finally, victims in Scotland will receive some sort of justice with this bill, but it will not undo the damage. But I do hope that it brings some small comfort that their name will be fully cleared. It is right that this legislation is treated as an emergency. The existing approach prior to the introduction of this bill has not been anywhere near swift enough. Just 6 convictions have so far been quashed, and it's estimated the number of convictions that may end up being overturned by this bill is in the hundreds, possibly thousands. I have to briefly pick up on the points made that the government wasted time on a constitutional spat with the UK government instead of recognising immediately that a bespoke solution would be required in Scotland, considering the unique elements of our justice system. It's been disappointing to see the SNP government attempt to politicise this scandal at various points, especially since it appeared for several months that the government was not speaking with one voice about their approach. The Lord Advocate appeared to be saying very different things than the previous First Minister or the Cabinet Secretary. At times, they seemed to be directly at odds with one another over what should happen. I hope the SNP will now set politics to one side, because that's what everyone here needs to do. We need to get the politics out of this, because every mainstream political party here shares some blame. As a result, I agree with the Cabinet Secretary about the need for the broad approach that this bill delivers. It's an exceptional response, but it is merited in this instance. What's undermined justice in this scandal is the actions of the Post Office and here in Scotland, the Crown Office. This legislation corrects terrible mistakes. It does not undermine justice, it delivers it. Some in the legal community, including the Lord Advocate, have suggested that mass exoneration could potentially mean the overturning of some convictions that do not represent a miscarriage of justice. But there are hundreds of innocent people who must deserve the most urgent of action. That is why this legislation that will bring justice to all those wrongfully accused and convicted is welcome. Turning to the role of the Crown, I agree with the comments from Fergus Ewing and Beatrice Wishart, who stated that there should be an investigation into why they acted the way they did. Describing it as a monumental cover-up, we need a cultural shift where people take responsibility, and we have to learn.
Michael Mara had said we cannot blindly put our faith in established organisations and we need to redouble our support for whistleblowers. The initial tainted evidence which convicted many innocent people came from the Post Office, but in Scotland the Crown Office pursued cases. They did so for several years after they became aware of concerns about the Horizon system. They cannot be swept under the rug. It has to be investigated and lessons must be learned. The Crown Office were often quick to prosecute, yet they've been slow to help the process of exoneration. One of the legacies of this scandal should be ensuring that the Crown Office learns from the serious failures involved in this scenario. In conclusion, today's debate has been a good starting point, which covered many of the key issues and considerations that should be at the forefront of our minds as this legislation quickly progresses. It is vital that we get this right, and we do so urgently. Victims of this scandal have already lost so much. Their former lives are gone, destroyed by the actions of the Post Office. We owe it to them to put politics aside and give them some small resolution by quashing their convictions as swiftly as possible. Thank you, President Officer.
Thank you. I now call on Angela Constance, up to 10 minutes or so, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and can I thank all members for their contributions this afternoon. And I want to start by agreeing with Sharon Dowie, or at least her opening remarks, that we should, at this juncture, be putting politics aside. Of course, Ms Dowie, it takes two to tangle. I will, of course, Presiding Officer, take away the points made in the Chamber today that are pertinent to the Scottish Government and the legislation before us, and give them all very serious consideration indeed. And after decision time, immediately after decision time, I will be meeting with my officials so that we can proceed to the next stage. I am particularly grateful to Beatrice Wishart and to Ruth Maguire for their very close and forensic attention to the bill in front of us. And like Claire Adamson, I too would like to pay tribute to the work that Marion Fellows has done, and of course many others have endured and tackled over many years prior to the TV programme. As I said in my opening remarks, this bill is absolutely vital in ensuring that Scottish postmasters are not disadvantaged compared to victims of the Post Office Horizon scandal in the rest of the UK. And everyone who has contributed to today's debate has spoke of the trauma associated with the injustice. And we know that these victims have lost their homes, reputations, some even their lives. They have waited very long, and indeed too long, to have their names and reputations cleared. And while the bill cannot change the past, I do hope that it will go some way in addressing these horrific miscarriages of justice. And I was very pained to hear Dr Allen's contribution in terms of the plight of his constituent, Mrs Quorm, and indeed her deceased husband, and how that family have still to receive the compensation. And if I can say to Dr Allen, and I would you'll make this offer to other members as well, that I have written to the UK Government in and around issues of compensation, but I am more than happy to follow up on my own correspondence on behalf of the Government with individual cases reflecting the concerns that constituency and regional MSPs will have. And I'm always happy to share what information I have. While the compensation schemes, there are three in existence, are the responsibility of the UK Government, but I'm happy to share whatever information I have if that is of assistance to members. Presiding Officer, I do believe that it is prudent not to complete Stage 3 before the UK Bill is passed in its final form, notwithstanding that there are some select differences with the Scottish Bill in comparison to the UK Bill, which it is by and large designed to mirror. And essentially, this is quite simply because I want to ensure parity in terms of how convictions are quashed, notwithstanding differences in Scots law. But More importantly, that there is care needed. There is great care needed to ensure that we are not rambunctious or cack-handed and do anything that jeopardises people's access to compensation. And as I've outlined to the Criminal Justice Committee, I will endeavour to make as much progress as possible, and that's why I've intimated that I will schedule the amending Stage 3 process. And if I can say to Jamie Green, who intimated that we should complete our process before the summer recess, I certainly hope that we can complete our process before summer recess. And we are following the UK Government Bill timetable very closely. The way they do things at Westminster is different, as is their right, and of course it is a bit of a movable flea piece. And I don't want to burst Mr Green's bubble, but he had said that if we were to complete the process and then, if need be, we could come back after summer recess and, you know, bring forward any further action. That further action would be a bill, but I have to also say to Mr Green that I wouldn't be waiting till after summer recess if I need to make a very respectful plea for Parliament to be recalled in the interest of swift action and swift justice. I can assure you I will not hesitate to do so. Presiding Officer, Mr Finlay raised some understandable questions in relation to why the response to the Scottish Criminal Cases Review Commission was so low. Other members, Audrey Nicholl in particular, have spoke to the actions undertaken by the Commission, who I can assure members did more than just write people a letter. They used tracing agents. They made attempts to trace next of kin where someone was deceased. They have went above and beyond, but the difficulties that they have encountered quite simply speaks to the need for this bill, because people have lost faith in our justice system. And I'm happy to give way to Mr Finlay.
Russell Finlay.
Just on that point, I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary can perhaps explain why the number of 73 is now potentially up to 2,000, where this huge gulf in figures has come from.
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm very grateful to Mr Finlay to have the opportunity to clarify that. There is up to 1,000 cases across the UK. We are not anticipating 2,000 wrongful convictions in Scotland, if I can just put that on record. The information that the Scottish Criminal Cases had came from the Crown and other sources, so they proactively wrote to, I think it's now actually nearly 80 people. And what I was saying to Mr Ewing earlier is that our best estimate here, and it is our best estimate, is around 200 convictions to be overturned. But what we will do to ensure that we leave no stone unturned because of that list of relevant offences, we will indeed go and look at thousands of cases where there is a listed relevant offence. And I'm happy to follow up in any further detail as Mr Finlay sees fit. Presiding Officer, if I can say to Claire Adamson in and around non-disclosure agreements that I very much appreciate her concern. NDAs are not part of the criminal law landscape, and the focus of this bill is to quash relevant criminal convictions. But there is a letter that the Post Office Limited sent to Liam Byrne, MP, Chair of the Business and Trade Committee, and I will share that correspondence. Again, it's somewhat complex. It might give some reassurance in some respects to the Horizon Shortfall Scheme, but it may raise other questions that members have. And of course, people may be aware that the Post Office Limited have waived their rights under NDAs for the purposes of the Sir Wynne Williams inquiry. And just to remind colleagues, Presiding Officer, that... yes, Mr Coffey.
Willie Coffey.
Cards in. Thank you. The massive failures by the Post Office have largely masked, though, the responsibility of the software writers Fujitsu for their errors leading to this scandal. Is the Cabinet Secretary aware that the Post Office, a UK government agency, has incredibly continued to award contract extensions to Fujitsu on this Horizon project, which it's still using, despite continuing reports of defects, to the tune of £95 million since 2021?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, in terms of Fujitsu, Fujitsu's role in the Horizon scandal is one of the issues which has rightly been reviewed by Sir Wynne Williams in terms of his statutory inquiry as instructed by the UK government. It's a matter of public record that Fujitsu has one contract with the core Scottish government. I know that my colleague Neil Gray, when he was in the previous position as Economy Secretary, that he certainly expressed this government's expectations in a range of pertinent matters. And in terms of the one contract that Fujitsu has, the electronic counting contract, that will be re-tendered before the next Scotland-wide local government elections. And also, Presiding Officer, while we are on the issue of the public inquiry, it's important to emphasise that the public inquiry is UK-wide, that includes Scotland, and that also includes prosecution services in Scotland. And the Scottish Government agreement to do that was signed off by my predecessor, Keith Brown. Presiding Officer, I'll just briefly say that in terms of potential amendments, I understand why Maggie Chapman and Pauline McNeill have raised their concerns and why they are advocating for this bill to apply to those who were not involved in operating a post office business or not involved in working in a post office business. There are some difficulties with that in terms of meeting the five criteria listed in the bill, and there are some risks around that, which I would be more than happy to discuss with Maggie Chapman and Pauline McNeill. Do I have time, Presiding Officer? Yes, okay.
Pauline McNeill.
Thank you very much. Cabinet Secretary, I appreciate that you're going to consider this. But one other thing to consider is that my case where he wasn't a sub-postmaster, the evidence used to convict him was still the same evidence, and there was no stealing of any money. So it bounced to the same principle.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I suppose just in terms of the here and now, if I can point members to the redress shortfall scheme. Obviously, we've discussed a lot the opportunities around the Scottish Criminal Cases Review Commission, but I think more fundamentally what I need to discuss with members on this particular issue is that where are we getting the balance right? Because we have a balance to strike here. And as Maggie Chapman and Jamie Green also acknowledged, that this is extraordinary circumstances that are resulting in the extraordinary action of Parliament passing a bill to overturn convictions. And I have to say, as Justice Secretary, this should in no way be a precedent, and it is a grave undertaking that we are doing. I believe that we are doing it for the very best of reasons. The bill as it stands already carries some risk, and we are carrying that risk because the priority is to capture all of those who have suffered a miscarriage of justice. But there will have to be, at the end of the day, and it will be for Parliament to decide, some limits on the scope of the bill. And in doing so, we will have to be absolutely clear that we have got the balance correct. Presiding Officer, can I just end by saying that I very much take the opportunity to reaffirm my commitment to work constructively with all parties in the Chamber to ensure that we overturn this unprecedented miscarriage of justice and ultimately deliver justice for postmasters in Scotland. And if I could say to Mr Ewan and indeed others, yes, of course, we've got work to do. We've got a lot of work to do to rebuild trust. We've got a lot of work to do in terms of addressing causes and consequences, and with members' cooperation, I am sure we'll do just that.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on Post Office Horizon System Offences Scotland Bill at Stage 1. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of Motion 13232. In the name of Shona Robison, on a financial resolution for the Post Office Horizon System Offences Scotland Bill. And I call on Angela Constance to move the motion.
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. The question on this motion will be put at decision time, and I am minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 11.2.4 of Standing Orders that decision time be brought forward to now, and I invite the Minister for Parliamentary Business to move the motion.
Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And the question is that decision time be brought forward to now. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed, and there are two questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first is that Motion 13292, in the name of Angela Constance, on the Post Office Horizon System Offences Scotland Bill at Stage 1 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. And the final question is that Motion 13232, in the name of Shona Robison, on a financial resolution for the Post Office Horizon System Offences Scotland Bill be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. And that concludes decision time. And we'll now move on to members' business in the name of Marie McNair.